because you are a chosen race. You are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you will proclaim the wonderful things of him who called you out of darkness into this marvelous light. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Set apart and set aside and do his work and bring him glory. Come on.
I'm not trying to blend in. I'm trying to stand out. I've been set apart for greatness. It's already planned out.
I got a question for you.
What's up?
Do you guys teach that?
These are sons?
No, my nephew. You can talk to them. Do you guys teach that you can do salvation?
Do?
Yeah, salvation. Yeah. Like someone that.
Thank you.
Being saved.
Christ says, we believe in Christ, the Bible. Yeah. Christ says, he that endures until the end shall be saved. Just like to get your high school diploma, you got to graduate.
Yeah.
But if you drop out, you can't get the diploma.
Yeah.
So if I'm in the walk for the Most High, I'm on the path to salvation. But if I quit, I go back to the world, I miss out on that opportunity.
So then how do you reconcile with the scripture what Jesus says?
So you get what I first said.
I said,
Matthew 24.
Yeah.
He that endures unto the end, the same shall be saved.
So I guess to address that scripture, I would say only the anointed can endure to the end, because the anointed are the only ones being protected by God.
But so, that's the same thing in the nutshell.
Well, so if you say someone endures to the end,
yes,
that means you kind of got to keep working for your salvation. But if there's a false convert that's within you, they won't be able to endure to the end because they're not being protected by God.
Well, I never said you have to keep working. You said that.
Yeah.
You said you have to keep. We're not saved by works.
So if you endure to the end, that means that you don't have salvation now, correct?
Salvation hasn't come.
So, okay, and there's a scripture, but I don't want to jump on topic. So I would say you are saved when you believe.
Saved from what?
Well, salvation, you have received the inheritance.
So let me backtrack. Let's backtrack. Why do you need Christ?
Why do I need Christ? Because of our sins.
Because of our sins. What about our sins?
Well, we have the wrath of God. We have broken God's law.
Yes.
So we need a Savior.
Yeah.
So we need Jesus.
Yes. So he pays our debt, right?
Yes.
Right. So what do we got to do? What's our obligation?
To believe. Have faith.
To believe. Faith without works is what?
Yeah.
Right. So what's the works? What we gotta do?
Believing on Christ.
Believing's not the action.
Well,
what do we have to physically do?
Well, believing justified.
Not really.
So your words are.
What did the disciples do? After Christ died, what did the disciples do?
They believed on him.
What did they do physically?
They went out and did the works.
What's the works?
I guess that's Ephesians 2:10. It's the works that God had predestined beforehand that they would walk in.
You've been saved by the Most High, and you know there's others out there that's not saved. What do you think you should do?
Spread the word.
That's what we're doing.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, that's the thing. So are you saved right now?
No. I have to endure until the end.
Okay, then you would have
to. I can go end my life suicidal. I lose that opportunity. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I get what you're saying about anointed. You're going into predestinated. I could be anointed, but we just anointed ourselves.
Yeah. That's the oil.
That's not saving.
That's like the oil. I'm talking about the anointed are the chosen. The anointed are the ones that God has picked beforehand to be saved. So I'm saying, if you're saying.
So what makes you call it chosen and faithful? Now you're putting words in my mouth. You're using a fixed conversation you might have had to yourself. And you're coming pigeonholed to me to words I'm not saying.
In Matthew 24:13, so someone says you can endure to the end, that means you don't have salvation.
That's what Christ says.
Yeah, actually.
Yeah. But that goes against what salvation is.
So what scripture do you have to go against with Christ? Christ said this, so you're saying Christ is wrong, but he says him that endures him to the end of the same church. So write that down to
me. Because when Christ said that, Christ also said, the one that the Father has given me, no one can snatch him out of my hand, no one can snatch him out of the Father's hand. So everyone in Jesus' hand is going to be saved. No one can take them, nothing can separate us from God.
Who's in his hand?
But no.
printed. So, what are they doing to be sealed? So no matter what they do, they can go rob, cheat, steal, commit adultery, and they're still saved?
That's 1 John. 1 John says someone that's been born of God, we don't keep them on going sinning.
So even what you're saying, the anointed chosen still got to follow some type of guidelines to seal.
Yeah.
Oh, they're not saved.
Oh, they're not saved.
Yeah, but if you are a new creation, you have new desires.
So let me ask you, are you born again?
Yes.
You are?
Yes.
So you don't lie, you don't cheat, you don't steal, you don't commit adultery.
But that's making it seem as if you're born again, you're perfect. You're not perfect. Born again.
Besides us being perfect, for I am.
Yes.
That's crazy.
Yeah. And if you're
so are you good enough to make it to heaven?
Yeah.
Yeah. So how many lies have you told in your whole life?
A lot.
What do you call someone that tells a lot of lies?
A liar.
Have you ever stolen anything in your whole life?
Yeah, it was very tough for you. I'm a thief. I'm a liar. Yeah. I failed all those tests. But I am I'm perfect in God's eyes. Why? Because of Jesus. So when God looks at me, I'm not a liar. I'm not a thief.
Have you ever took God's name in vain
before? Yeah.
So that's blasphemy.
Yeah, I'm a blasphemer. I'm
adulterer. Christ says, "Whoever looks with lust, commit adultery already in his heart." Have you ever looked with lust? Right. Yeah. Have you ever hated someone?
Yeah.
So on the day of judgment, would you be innocent or guilty?
What did God do? God sent His Son.
Right.
God sent His Son.
And you understand that obligation? So let's put it in this scenario.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm on this corner with you and someone starts shooting bullets, and I caught the bullet for you, I don't die, I go to the hospital, would you come visit me? Why?
Because the obligation, what you did.
Would you appreciate
praise
what
Lord,
I did?
Praise the Lord, what's going on
with you? Come
to
see me.
I do.
You see my family coming, my children coming in. How you going to feel now?
Well, that should make me want to change my life.
Praise the Most High.
Yeah, I gotta buy that.
That's what we're talking about.
But
because I don't want you to think that works goes into applying only the Ten Commandments because we're saved by it.
Yeah,
but grace doesn't excuse us from keeping the law.
So, then how are you saved?
By enduring into the end.
Okay, so you're not.
So let's get it. Let's give me Isaiah 49 and 3.
So the work of Jesus is not enough to save you, saved.
I didn't say that.
Well, you just said you got to endure to the end. So enduring to the end is saying that what Jesus did was not enough.
That's not what I'm saying.
So I'm asking.
I'm going to show you. So I try to give you a scenario because if I went to that, like you visit me in the hospital and I'm shot, you're going to be like, hey, to my mother, hey, what can I do to help you? You know, you saved my life. You need some money. What do you need? So you know when Christ died for you, what are you going to do for those that don't know about that? Christ died for the world, right?
But that's different.
How are you going to tell them?
But that's different.
But I'm trying to show you what the works are.
But it's different.
I'm going to show you.
That's different from justification.
Because I deal with the Bible.
Yeah, I deal with the Bible too. It's different from justification.
What scripture that you have to go against what Christ says? See, that endures into the end.
But what you're saying is that we're justified by our works. That's not true. In God's eyes.
I didn't say that.
But when you quote the scripture,
the Bible doesn't teach that. So that's false.
When you quote the scripture, I got to endure to the end. That's a works based salvation.
So that's why I give you an opportunity. What does Christ break down what Christ is saying?
That's what I'm asking. How were you justified in God's eyes? So when
time out. You're answering the question with a question.
Yeah.
Break down what Christ meant in Matthew 24. He that endures until the end, the same shall be saved.
The one that doesn't fall back, and that's the ones that are being preserved. The one that's being preserved.
Brother, you're on the same page as us. I think you answered your own question. Yeah.
But I think what we differ is justification. So if I come to you and say, I believe in Jesus Christ, am I justified?
I think you're bringing your own arguments to the table.
Where am I justified?
Because I believe the Bible and you're quoting scriptures.
I'm asking, am I justified?
Are you made innocent because you have Christ?
Because I believe.
That's obvious. The wages of sin is death. We all should be dead, but Christ makes us justified. But there's an obligation. I'm going to show you.
Okay, but hold on. You said an obligation is added to it. Is my faith alone justify me in God's eyes?
No. Faith without works is dead.
Okay, see now.
You can't just believe and be saved.
Let's go to that scripture because you're taking it out of context.
Well, I'm trying to tell you because with Christ, it's a relationship. He saved you. Now you're no longer servants, you're friends.
But you just
said, I want to show you because it's a relationship.
Yeah.
In a relationship, are you married?
Yes.
So what would your wife rather hear? I love you, you love her, or she want to see you that you love her?
My words should be enough. But I hear what you're saying, but my words should be enough.
How is your words going to be enough?
That's
the worst.
It's a different situation.
What if
it's
telling
apples,
you love it and you're going
to apples and oranges. I hear what you're saying, but it's apples and oranges. When it comes to God,
that's not what the scripture says.
No.
Let's talk.
Let's talk
scriptures. Let's go to Titus 1:16. Titus 1:16. Let's get off the page. Titus 1:16. Let me show you something.
children.
Oh, Brandon, you can give them something.
I want to make it clear, you did say that our faith is not enough.
I didn't say that.
You said faith alone is not enough. You said you have to
faith without works is dead. That's okay. The scripture. Yeah. Titus 1:16. I'm going to show you something. I appreciate it. What's your name?
Ryan.
Ryan, Jacob.
Jacob.
We're from the Gathering of Christ Church.
Okay.
And I'm glad you're able to contend with your faith. Right? But we want to show you what we've been established on and what principles come from the Bible. We error not knowing the scriptures.
Right.
So I hope we can come to an agreement through the scriptures.
Yeah.
Right? No one's saved just by believing. Listen, the law is the schoolmaster to get us in Christ. Did Christ just believe in God and just sat there? Or did he do something? Christ said, if you love Christ, feed his sheep.
You have to explain Ephesians 1:13-14, where it says believing is enough.
I'm not going
to
use Paul against Christ. Christ is over Paul. So remember that.
But Paul
so you have to understand Paul
was inspired by God. Was Paul not inspired by God?
Inspired by God.
So that's God.
I'm sure I'm not saying they go against each other.
You just did.
Don't pigeonhole Paul saying it and not first understanding Christ. Christ is the head of the church. He's the body.
Yeah.
So you should always start with Christ.
Who's Paul's leader?
Titus 1:16. Let's get it.
Test 1-2. Titus chapter 1 verse 16. Bring it out. They profess that they know God. They profess that they know God, but what? But in works they deny him. Read it again. They profess that they know God. So I know God. I believe in God. I talk to God. Right? Read. But in works they deny him. So in their works, this is Paul, brother. See, so Ron, I need you to,
because
I'm trying to talk, and this is how we don't never get to a plane as a people. We don't listen. That's why the Most High gave us two ears, so we listen twice as much as we speak. And I get it. You online, you surfing the web, you hearing this and hearing that. I think your point of getting across is more important than you learning. So you may not understand where we're coming with. But read what Paul is saying. And again, on to Paul. You quoted Paul. Let's use Paul. 16 from the top. They profess that they know God.
Uh-huh.
But in works, they deny him. They deny him in their works. Why? Because you can't just say you love God. Give me 1 John 2 and 3. You can't just say you love God and you're saved. The Savior says, him that endures shall be saved. Endure what? Endure means to suffer patiently. 2 Timothy 3 and 12 says, anyone that believes in Christ shall go through persecution. 11 out of the 12 disciples were murdered, brother. Christ was murdered. Why? Because he was speaking truth. Right?
So the question is, when Jesus says no one can snatch him out of my hand, what does that mean?
1 second. Read this, because I'm trying to show you something that would answer your question. This is the book of 1 John, chapter 2, verse 3. This is the New Testament too, right? Read. And hereby we do know that we know him. We know the Most High by what? If we keep his commandments.
If we what?
If we keep his commandments.
If we what?
If we keep his commandments.
Come on.
He that saith, I know him.
Oh, I know the Most High. He's in my heart. He's my Savior, right? Read.
And keepeth not his commandments.
Come on.
Is a liar.
Is a what?
Is a liar.
Is a what?
Is a liar.
You're a liar.
Read. And the truth is not in him.
And the truth is not in him. Why call ye me Lord, Lord? You don't do the things that I say.
Right? According to what I brought out, you believe that, right? Right, so I'm guessing you're going to go into those that's predestinated. Am I right?
What was your question? Like, what's your question after reading those scriptures? What question would you have to
be? I have no questions.
Without works,
if it's dead. Okay. That's James.
Yeah.
You get that. That's true. Hold on. Let's get one thing at a time. Without works, faith is dead, correct?
Yes.
Right?
Romans 4. Bring
out
Romans 4.
Yeah, it's true.
Romans 4 is a TKL tour.
Yeah, and that's what I'm trying to get to, because I think we're not getting the understanding of the scriptures, right?
What I'm saying is, once you believe,
yep,
you are
are justified. That means you are declared righteous in God's eyes. You are sealed with the Holy Spirit. You are saved. Then the works.
So what does it mean to believe in Christ?
It means your faith. You have to fully trust. You fully put your trust.
How do you trust?
Repent.
How do you repent? Repent from what?
Repent. 2 Corinthians 7:9, you have a God.
So what do you trust in? What makes you a new person? What makes you born again? What changes your thoughts and transforms your mind?
The Bible says you have godly sorrow.
Yeah.
You have godly sorrow for how you have wronged God. That changes your
but
mind.
But what are you doing? Changes your mind to do what?
Yeah, God gives you his spirit, and the spirit helps you produce the good works. No one without God's spirit can produce good works.
So we're going to end up going in circles. Do you still keep the commandments? Exactly. That's all I'm saying. Amen. That's what we're saying, right? So I'll let you talk to the brother off the side, but we got a message to put out here, right? Nope. Well, who's out here?
But yet we have all these different beliefs, and everybody says, oh, well, that's the way you interpret it, right?
Yeah.
And we're not supposed to be interpreting. So what you guys were talking about, mind you, I showed up a little late, so I don't know exactly what y'all were going into, but what I heard is what we have found, to do the research in secular history, is that all these religions, right, there's some truth in them,
marvelous day.
But then there's some lies in them. Right.
Like the brothers of the gathering of Christ Church, and yes, sister.
But why when I go to church, this teaching, you know, feed the sheep, feed the nativity, it's Christmas time.
Yeah. And put the message out there, right?
So
we got a lot of things going on, a lot to touch on.
You guys are talking about faith versus works, right?
Yeah.
And the agreement is that no, we can't justify.
So we got a lot of information to put out here. We got a lot of
faith.
The link
is with those two, right?
Because we're going to do
a bunch of research, right, about faith and works. That's why he asked you about love, right?
Yeah.
Is love an action word? Because it's not an action word. Apples and oranges. Because we say we love God, but how do we show that we love God? Just me saying it through my words?
We're from the same city, the same streets, just like
you. You mind getting me? But you got it?
And we're
the scriptures that
it's not the love
right,
we receive in this world.
We're
speaking of the love of truth.
James 2, 17 and 18.
I tell you one thing about truth.
Come on
ahead.
So,
and we're sorry that you did that with truth.
If it has not works, is dead, being alone. Verse 18. Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works.
I know what verse 14 says about what doeth a prophet, my brethren? A man say he hath faith and have not works, can faith save him, right? So what this is talking about, this one said, doubling, you can't just say we have faith, because look at the scripture, and if you stay there, is that talking about faith from man's point of view or God's point of view? If you read that again,
what did Christ say? There's only one faith, right?
No, there's only one faith, but that's talking about how to justify yourself in God's eyes, not man's eyes.
What are we talking about in God's eyes? We're not dealing with men.
But that passage talking about men.
He's just saying that when it comes to the Most High, right? When it comes to God, we can't just say we have faith. We can't just say we are right. And here's the proof of that. Hit James 1.
What's 15?
If a brother or sister be naked, destitute of daily food. What doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and have not works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister be naked, destitute of daily food. 16. And one of you say unto him, depart in peace, be ye warm and filled. Notwithstanding, you give them not those things which are needful to the body. What doth it profit? Even so, faith, if it have no works, is dead. I mean, this is making a point. It's making it clear, like, if you don't do these things for this person, it's like, it's dead. So they need both.
Do you understand what I'm talking? That's talking about for the human point. So if he says, I have faith, and he will even help his brother, his faith is not real. That's talking about from the man's point of view. That's not talking about God's point of view.
But this is saying if he needs something, and I'm saying I love you, but I don't give you what you need, the works part, what I'm saying to you don't matter. It's dead. Just like with Christ, if I say I have faith and I'm not doing the works, I'm not doing this right now, or what he told you to do, then my faith that I'm saying I have is dead. It's the same.
So that's why the analogy was put in there. That's what you're saying, but that's why the analogy was on YouTube. That's what he was saying. He was making the connection between just as it, because we're flesh, we're people, right? So he's making the analogy. He's like, listen, in order to have true faith in the Most High, there's got to be something that backs that up, right? And here's the proof. Let's look at the Bible. Go over to James chapter 1. Just start in verse 22. Here's what it says, right? Confirmation.
This is the spirit of the Most High that he gives us freely. He wants us informed.
22. Yep.
But
be doers of the word.
Doers of the word.
Doers. That's an action, right? Not just what? Keep going. But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only.
And hold on a second. And what was the word? What was the word? So what was the word? Hold on. What was the word? He said, be ye doers of the word, right? His commandments. And one of his commandments was what? Matthew 24:14. Go therefore and teach all nations, and then the end will come. Matthew 28:19-20. That is a commandment from Christ. That's Christ's words.
Are you talking about the two commandments he gave?
But the two commandments about love, loving God and loving your neighbor. That's also all under that. All the law falls under those two things. The whole law, in those are works, right? You see what it says like this, right? For if any be a hearer of the word, 23.
For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. 24. For he beholdeth himself and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was.
Right? Keep going. 25.
But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein.
So hold up. So you have to continue in that law of liberty, right? Now remember, we're not under the law. But Paul himself said in Romans chapter 3 that we establish the law. Because the law just shows us what sin is. Right? The law just shows us what sin is. So that's why we see the law and we're like, okay, well, if sin, if the definition in the Bible for sin is transgression of the law in 1 John 4:3, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Then what we have to do is we observe the law, as Paul said in Romans 3:31, right? Because he says in Romans 3:20, I didn't know sin except for the law, right? So again, this isn't saying we're under the law, because under the old law, there was no room for repentance.
Yep.
You get that, right? And so this is what he's talking about. This, that law, it's still about observing that law and keeping the commandments of God, meaning loving God and loving neighbor, right?
And what does that mean? That when we say observe, if I don't want to observe it, can I be your brother?
Before that, man, I just really want to understand where that question came from. You just asked it, right? But I didn't understand why you was asking it. I wanted to know where it came from, right? Because if you can understand that faith without works is dead, why would you It's like you want us to be like, oh yeah, I mean, if I have faith, then I'm justified. So I want to know, where is that coming from? If you understand faith without works is dead, because if you can take me when we're in the one place in the Bible and say that, and I can take you here in the Bible and do that, that's not, there's no contradiction. It must be something that's not being understood between the two verses.
Yeah, because when someone says they don't have salvation now, salvation is talked about in the present tense, the past tense, and the future tense. Ephesians 2:8 says, we are saved by grace, by faith. Saved is in the aorist tense. So if you look at the Greek, the aorist tense is talking about something that's been done in the past. It has no reputation for the past or the future. So it says we've been saved. So there's a point in time, once you believe, you are saved. And you, like Ephesians 1:13 said, you will gain that inheritance that you're going to receive later. So when someone tells me I'm not endured to the end, that means I don't have salvation to the end. And that goes against the Bible. So that's what I'm trying to understand.
So,
okay, where's the Bible?
But to say that, that's like you knowing what we just talked about. That's what I said. Yes, I'm saved. You want faith, but how can, where the salvation part, if through my faith, all of a sudden I decide to do X, Y, and Z?
You won't do that.
But that's not true. But that's not true. We do it all the time.
If someone is saved,
that's not true.
So if someone's saved, they're not going to want to go back. Why is the thing of God's spirit? And that was a bigger question. So if you tell me someone can lose their salvation, where in the Bible does it say that you can lose the Holy Spirit?
Oh, I'll show you right now. So this is where I'm getting at, right? This, the doctrine that you're talking about, hold up, that's a doctrine, right? And that actual doctrine came from the Catholic Church. That doctrine is called once saved, always saved, okay, right? And the reason why they do, that's why they baptize infants, right? Now, if I were to ask you, what is baptism? What is the purpose of baptism? What would you say?
To show God the good conscience and show people what you believe in.
According to the Bible, that's not right. According to the Bible, that's part of repentance. Right? What's part of repentance? Baptism. Baptism is for repentance.
So that's nothing for you.
Go to Acts 2:38, please. 3,000 souls got baptized.
Christ got baptized.
How are you
going to
say that?
That
meant nothing.
Right? Are you saying that
washing is that's part of the repenting process that Christ said. And there's no one higher than the Bible than Christ.
I'm just saying, so does repentance wash you from your sin, or does baptism wash you from your sin?
Both. But you have to have. But you have to.
Bible. After you get baptized, you walk in repentance.
I do have to.
Here's what we do, right? So when people a lot, like we had these conversations before, right? And they'll say, listen, you just wash yourself with the word, you get baptized, da 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 da, right? And what you're doing, what we do, is we go like this. Show me in the Bible where it says that you don't need baptism, right? Because we don't say anything that's not in the scripture, right? But we try to rightly divide the word.
Everything
should be understood. So when you go to Acts 2:38 and you go to Matthew 28:19-20, and there's more precepts that say about baptism, it's like if you don't get baptized, you can't be saved. If you don't get baptized,
look at that. We're baptism. When you're going to back out here, can I do that?
Well, check it out. Watch me.
Yeah. Christ told me. The Christ told John 3. He told Nicodemus what he had to do.
Be born again. He said, be born again.
How?
Be born again. That's spiritual.
How?
We repent.
But how did he tell him? In the Bible, how did he tell Nicodemus?
How did he be born of the Spirit?
How? How do you receive the Holy Spirit? According to the Bible, how do you receive the Holy Spirit? No, that's not true.
Ephesians 1:13,
the Bible says.
How did Christ get it? What did Christ do as an example for all of us?
He got baptized.
And then at that moment, what happened?
He received the Holy Spirit.
So you know the answer.
But then you have the Bible.
What happened? I'm sorry.
And then you would have clear examples of people who received the Holy Spirit before baptism.
You do. Like who?
Acts 10.
Yo, the Acts of the disciples all about baptism people.
He received the angel came to him and told him to learn under Peter.
Sure.
That's what it says.
In the scriptures, he received.
No. He doesn't. Bro. Again. He doesn't have informal with you, right? But if we go to Acts 10:38, that whole thing is about Cornelius, who was found to be a pious man. Pious, right? Meaning he fasted, he gave alms, right? And it, and because of that, his prayers said they were heard. And an angel appeared to him. The angel said, listen, send for this man Peter, right? Who Christ built was the rock of the church, right? Then Peter comes up to him, and he basically is like, you're supposed to, I was told that you were supposed to instruct me in the ways of how to repent and, you know, worship the true God.
Yeah.
Right? And so that's what he did. There's nowhere where in the Bible where it says he received any Holy Spirit before he was baptized. It doesn't say that in Acts chapter.
Right. It says Acts 10:44. Come on, you there.
Go ahead.
It says, while Peter was still saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. So they're receiving the Holy Spirit, and the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. And it says, so they were hearing them speaking in tongues and extolling to God. Then Peter declared, can anyone withhold water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have? Then they get baptized.
That spirit that they received right then was that spirit of understanding. Because they
Holy
spoke.
Spirit.
Yes, they spoke, but that spirit wasn't the spirit that... That same spirit, when you get baptized, just like Christ did, and you receive that Holy Spirit, right? Now, let me ask you this. Would you say that Christ had this Holy Spirit before he got baptized, or when he got baptized and received it then?
That's when he received it. That's when God wanted him to receive it. But you just told me no one got the Holy Spirit before they got baptized. And
so the Holy Spirit was working with those people so that they could understand. So that they could understand Peter. You just said they heard him speaking in their language, right?
But they couldn't do that until the
remember
Holy
what
Spirit.
Happened at Pentecost?
But they couldn't do that until the Holy Spirit fell on
them. Right, so the Holy Spirit pervaded all of them there. But the Holy Spirit that Christ walked with, that Holy Spirit, it's the same Holy Spirit, and she gives, and it's a feminine spirit, but she gives certain power. Okay. So she can reveal things, because the Bible says the Holy Spirit can walk with you before you, you know, while you're in wickedness, right? The Holy Spirit walks with you in crooked ways, is what the Bible says. So why does the Bible say that?
But you just told me no one can receive the Holy Spirit until they're baptized. And right there, someone received the Holy Spirit until they get baptized.
Again, that was that power of the Holy Spirit allowing them to understand the words that Peter was saying and teaching. But as he just said, then they needed to get baptized. So they would receive the portion of the Holy Spirit. I'm not going to deny it.
When you receive the portion, you see the whole thing.
So again, this debate is about you believe that the Bible is saying you don't need to be baptized for repentance or to receive the Holy Spirit.
No, you don't.
You
see the Holy Spirit once you believe.
And your belief is what? Believing in what? What do you believe?
Jesus.
So if I didn't know you and you said, hey brother, you need to believe in Jesus, what does that mean? How do I teach me how I'm supposed to believe in Jesus?
The wages of sin. 2 Corinthians says you have godly sorrow for what you have done. Okay. You all broke God's law. You all need to repent. You all have sin.
Can you get the direct scripture? Where it says, can I give you give me my number?
Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you for giving us your time.
I was with me through it all.